Spongy moth, which was formerly known as gypsy moth, is a moth that's native to Europe and Asia. It's in the family Lepidoptera, which includes butterflies and moths. And it is a very voracious leaf feeder. The caterpillar will feed on over 300 species of trees and shrubs, but it does have a strong preference for oak. And because of the wide variety of species that it will feed on, it's commonly considered to be the number one forest pest in the United States. This shows the life cycle of the spongy moth and the times on the calendar when the different stages of that life cycle would be visible. So currently, we would see egg masses, which can be located on trees or other outdoor objects. And they're in the lower left, you can see an egg mass. It's sort of a tan color, usually an inch or so in size and kind of fuzzy, velvety to the touch, and spongy, which is where the spongy moth gets its common name. So beginning in mid-April in the spring, small caterpillars would emerge from the egg mass, and those caterpillars will feed on foliage and continue to eat leaves and grow sort of throughout the spring. And as they grow, they'll develop some marked coloration along their backs. As you can see in the second picture, they have six pairs of red dots and five pairs of blue dots along their back. And then eventually, after having eaten enough and grown enough, they'll go into a resting stage, which we call the pupa stage, which is typically in the middle of June and into July, and after which they will emerge as the adult moth. The adult moth, really its main goal is to reproduce, and the adult moths can be found throughout the summer from either late June or early July through September. And the female moths don't fly, but they do emit a pheromone, which is kind of a signal that brings the male moths to them. So the male moths fly and they will orient towards that pheromone to find the females to mate with. And after they mate, the females will lay the eggs and cover them over, and eventually the adults will die and the eggs will go over the winter. Spongy moth can have a pretty significant impact on trees, and all of that impact comes from the feeding of the caterpillars. The caterpillar is the stage that does all the damage. There is a preference, as I mentioned, for oak among other species. There are some certain characteristics of the trees that will make them more susceptible to the defoliation that's caused by the caterpillars. If a tree is old or if it's newly planted and doesn't have well-established roots, it may not respond well to that defoliation. Or trees that are always or that are already under stress for other reasons, whether it be drought or soil compaction, will also have a harder time recovering from defoliation. Another thing that occurs when the tree is stressed is that secondary invaders like insect borers and fungi might take advantage of the weakened trees and infiltrate those trees and cause further harm. Depending on the intensity of that defoliation that occurs and how frequently the trees are defoliated can have a pretty strong impact on whether or not the trees will survive. This chart shows the results of a 10-year study in Pennsylvania where spongy moth is pretty well established, and it looks at the mortality of trees after consecutive years of being defoliated by spongy moth. And what you can see from this chart is that after 1 year of defoliation, a large percentage of the trees will recover and survive. But if you have two consecutive years or three consecutive years, a much greater percentage will die due to the defoliation. And in the case of oak specifically, by the second year, almost 90% of trees that have been defoliated will die. So clearly it's important that we take action to protect these trees from spongy moth. Some of the other impacts that spongy moth can have, there are environmental impacts that result from the defoliation, which include increased amount of light and temperature that's penetrating to the forest floor or water surfaces that would typically be shaded by the canopy. It can enhance the effect of drought. It can decrease the growth of understory plants, which are used to being shaded over and growing in those shady conditions. And because of the mortality, you can have a decreased number of oaks. And that can have impacts on wildlife populations, especially those that feed on acorns. The canopy loss can make nests of songbirds more susceptible to predation and can leave fewer safe harbors for other native butterflies and moths. The penetration of the light can cause changes in water temperature in surface water that's typically shaded, and that can affect the wildlife in the water as well. And beyond these impacts sort of to the ecosystem, there are impacts to humans themselves. A large number of caterpillars feeding in an area can be a really serious nuisance because as they feed, they generate waste, and that waste will rain down from the trees where they're feeding. The caterpillars also can be an allergen to some people who are sensitive to them, and the tiny hairs on them can irritate people's skin. And there can be general loss of enjoyment of recreational activities when there are heavy populations of spongy moth feeding. You also will see reduced timber value because dead trees aren't as useful in timber, and dead trees also can cause reduced property values. I guess most importantly, dead trees can be a really serious safety hazard and can cause insurance issues as well. Spongy moth first was brought to the U.S. in the 1860s, and at that time there was a really big press for increased production in silk. The idea was that the spongy moth could be crossbred with a silkworm to make a more productive silkworm. And the person who brought them was keeping them in an outdoor enclosure, and there was a storm that caused damage to that enclosure, and some of the caterpillars escaped. And by 1882, there was the first major outbreak of spongy moth in the U.S., which occurred in Medford, Massachusetts. In 1889, the Massachusetts government began the first eradication program for spongy moth in the United States. By 1900, Massachusetts ended those eradication efforts, and it's not clear if they ran out of money or if they thought they had eradicated. But shortly after that time, spongy moth resurfaced and spread throughout much of New England. And by the 1930s, most of New England was under quarantine regulations, and spongy moth continued to spread westward and southwest to the current day, where we have 22 states and much of eastern Canada where spongy moth can be found. Here in Ohio, the first detection of spongy moth were egg masses that were found in Cuyahoga County and then later destroyed. The first male moths trapped in Ohio were in Ashtabula County, which is in the northeast corner of the state. In the 80s, Ashtabula County became the first county in Ohio to be placed under a spongy moth quarantine. And there was continued spread. And today we have 51 counties which are under regulations for spongy moth. Throughout the 70s and up through the 90s, the only real treatment was spot eradication treatments in Ohio. And in the late 90s, the U.S. Forest Service introduced a new strategy. And that strategy stemmed from the production of a pheromone, a copy essentially of the pheromone that the female uses to lure males towards it for mating. And because of that, the Forest Service was able to place traps with this pheromone lure throughout the state of Ohio to determine population densities. Some of what they learned in this trapping project was that the spongy moth spread doesn't expand as a continuous wave, but rather there are distinct little colonies and pockets of infestation that pop up along that leading edge. Managing those colonies sort of introduced a new strategy to reduce the spread of spongy moth. That strategy would break the area up into three separate zones. There's the suppression zone, which is the generally infested area where spongy moth is known to be pretty much everywhere within that area. The slow the spread zone or the transition zone is the area where those distinct colonies are found and where the infestation is spreading. It's sort of the leading edge. And then the eradication zone is the area that is known not to have populations of spongy moth. And in those areas, the object would be to completely eradicate small populations if they did pop up. So just to give a little more detail on the strategy, pheromone traps were placed throughout the state. They use this synthetic pheromone lure to attract male moths that are in the area. They're only able to detect this pheromone within a certain radius. So we're not bringing in moths from other areas towards these traps. We're just finding the ones that are already there. And the data that they collect by trapping throughout the state is used to measure the spread of spongy moth. It's used to establish the boundaries of those three zones that I just mentioned. And it's also used to detect potential problem areas and prioritize them. Potential problem areas are areas where the population seems to be growing quickly and could be another way of describing those individual colonies. This data also allows us to make recommendations on what sort of treatments can be done and to evaluate treatments that have been done in the past. One of the outcomes of statewide trapping each year is developing these project boundaries, and it looks at moth lines, which are average moth catches, which are spread out across the states. So essentially, we look at where the average catch is 100 moths, where the average catch is 30 moths, where it's 10 moths, where it's 3, and where it's 1. And that 10 moth line is maybe the most important line because it marks the beginning of that action zone, that slow the spread area in the transition where we see those distinct colonies. That slow the spread zone is determined by that 10 moth line and a line that's 100 kilometers ahead of that 10 moth line. And all of the slow the spread program work occurs within that area. There's additional work that would occur in the eradication zone, but it falls under another program. There's a decision algorithm which identifies those potential problem areas. This is essentially a computer model that looks at the trap catches throughout the state and shows us where it's growing quickly, where it needs to be addressed. And then there's a sort of a three-year process to how we address populations. So in our statewide trapping survey, we do a general grid at a certain space. And when we find positive catches, when we find spongy moths in the traps, the following year we'll do what's called a delimit, where we do additional trapping around it to sort of define the edges of that population. And then in the third year, we'll take that defined area and we'll apply some sort of treatment to it. And then we will evaluate it with a second delimit to see how effective that treatment was. Some of the results of this program, it's working very well. So nationwide, the spread rate of spongy moth has been reduced by 70%. And the goal of the project was to reduce by 60%. So you can see we're exceeding that goal. The natural spread rate, which is shown in the top left map, is the projected spread rate if there were no Slow the Spread program. You can see it would move throughout much of the eastern United States very quickly. That natural spread rate is about 13 miles per year. So that's pushing the line forward quite a bit. But with the Slow the Spread program, that spread rate has been reduced to just 2.1 miles per year. And in Ohio, we've actually done better than the national average. We've managed to push the line back by 2.6 miles per year over the last 23 years where we've had a program. And when you add that all up, that's a total of almost 60 miles back that we've pushed the line. So in that large map on the right-hand side, you can see in 1999 what that transition zone was marked by the red lines. And the blue lines represent what the transition zone is now in 2023. So just further illustration of how we've pushed the line back on Spongy Moth over those years.